My name is Rebecca Salzer. I'm an associate professor at the University of Alabama, and I'm really delighted to be with you for this workshop today. Thank you to Evans and Louisa for driving the Zoom. And thank you to the Miami Light Project for hosting this. I want to start off by acknowledging that I am on the traditional lands of the Creek and Choctaw, and that the area I'm in is named after Chief Tuscaloosa, who died in 1540 defending his land against the conquistadors in the southern part of what we now call Alabama. In the mid 1800s, the land that I'm on was the Mars family plantation. And that plantation, as well as the building I'm sitting in, which was built in 1844, were built by enslaved laborers. And I just want to acknowledge their presence and their contributions to what I'm able to do and to share with you today. So, yes, thank you. Thank you to all the ancestors in this place. I have ideas about what I want to present to you today, but, and I'm hoping that we can have a conversation. So I have material to present, but I'm also hoping that this can be a conversation and be about where you find yourself, where you find yourselves and the thoughts you have around that. This, in addition to a land acknowledgement, this is a really intense time, an intense week, an intense year. And I think it's important to be explicit about where we are and what we need and present that to each other as we talk. And along those lines, I didn't know this before this workshop was scheduled, but at 5:30 today, Eastern time, there is a candle lighting ceremony and a bell ringing ceremony being held nationwide for the victims of COVID-19. And so when it gets to 5:30, I would love it if we could just take a moment, have a moment of silence to observe that. Thank you for nodding. I'll take that as assent. I wanna start actually. So, you know, today is about, in some ways, how our embodied practices have become two-dimensionalized right now. And I actually want to start by three-dimensionalizing ourselves for a minute again and standing up and doing a quick practice, if that's okay with you. This is a vision therapy exercise. And what we're going to do is... start by just looking around and seeing that there's a room in back of you and space all around you. And this is mostly a vision exercise, but we can actually, we can make this walk, we can make this move. So starting with your hands on your chest and making your gaze open and wide, we're just going to keep the open gaze, keep the wide gaze, and bring our arms out to the sides and try to see the tips of our fingers in our peripheral vision as well as all the space in front of us. And then bring your hands back to your chest, trying to stay aware of your hands and the space in front of you. Just do that a couple of times. There's no right shape for it. It's just kind of exploring the limits of your visual periphery. How wide can you see both hands? And back to your chest. Just do that a few more times, or actually maybe one more time. This next time we're gonna go out the same way. But then without looking, keeping all of it in our periphery, we're going to try to touch our middle fingers without looking directly at our middle fingers. So we're looking generally and in an open way out in front of ourselves, keeping our hands in our peripheral vision. So that's the sequence. Now I added a piece. So from the chest to arms extended, touching the fingers without looking at them, which sometimes doesn't work all that well. Back to open and back to your chest. And you've been so accommodating so far. I'm going to invite you just to walk that around your space. Same sequence. So just to add movement to that, to take that sequence into your space. Seeing in front of you, seeing around you. Take another few moments, maybe one more full cycle, and then we'll come back to our screens. Thanks, everybody. Okay. So hopefully that kind of got us out of this little boxed area. And if you'll permit me to be a little highfalutin, I feel like this idea of seeing past our own nose is so important right now. trying to get out of our own frame of reference and see past our own noses. So I think it's important to the discussion we're gonna have, as well as just getting through the next week ahead of us. So there's two kind of overarching themes that I wanna open up for discussion today, and they intertwine a little bit. But one is what's being made right now, what we're seeing being made during the pandemic, what the landscape of new work is during the pandemic. And the other is how the ways that we have limited access and preservation of recorded dance are affecting us within this landscape, if that makes sense. So does that make sense? Yeah, okay. So if you feel comfortable unmuting yourself, how are you feeling? What are you seeing around you? Where does it feel like you are in terms of translating? Yes, I'm not even going to finish the question because Cora's raised her hand.
I mean, I don't know exactly how I am, but it's been, you know, a horrific time. And, you know, in the world and in this place, and having just the other day been driving from Florida back north, and, you know, coming across just an entire store that's only Trump. It's only a Trump store. And much more. you know, I feel personally fragile. And I feel like the relief that we had for about 20 minutes after the election, it's just so tenuous and scary. That said, I'm, you know, I am relieved that we have some decency and compassion coming back into the, at least the presidency. And personally, I, the last couple months of like teaching, I teach at Kenyon College, has been, that was really beautiful in the fall, in spite of all the weirdness. But the break has been just a shit show. My mom broke her hip, left against medical advice after I was super careful. She gave me COVID. So it's been, it's been wild. So right now I just feel super grateful to be okay. I had a rough few weeks of respiratory stuff. So that's where I'm at. It's kind of fragile, but
yeah,
grateful.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And I'm glad you're okay too.
I'll go next. Hi, everyone. Yeah, I would say that most of the time I'm doing well, and been finding a lot of refuge in my art making, and putting a focus on self-preservation in these like really wild times. And I think that I feel really inspired by how necessary art is right now. And I feel like just like by still creating, just keeping with momentum is what has been helping me the most to understand what's going on right now. Yeah.
Thank you. Lucia, are you okay to talk, or would you like to? Or?
I can speak now, I guess. for me, this whole year was an interruption in every sense, because I, not only for everybody, but I had just moved here to the mountains of North Carolina from Miami. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of starting to get to know people, and then, so I feel extremely isolated completely. So I've been in this little space for a long time, because I need to connect with friends and family, and the current situation in the country is really affecting me in a whole other level, because I grew up in a dictatorship. I grew up in a right-wing dictatorship. And for a long time I've been saying, you gotta pay attention. This is too much. It's gonna happen at any time. And so I'm really, because it's there. Mm-hmm. I don't think it will solve anything by getting rid of him, because what I feared before, it's already there. The whole machine of the government is infiltrated already with this kind of people. And it's gonna be a long time to clean everything if we can. So I feel a lot of anger, fear, all mixed. And I hope that I can, at some point, not right now because it's boiling, put this in my work. Mm-hmm. I've been working with my former students in Brazil, doing a film and figuring it out. How can we come together from such a distance? And it's been fun. This has really been fun, because we're experimenting different things and trying different duets, and like each one in one part. And so it's been fun. Let's see what's gonna come out of it.
Thank you. A great segue into talking a little bit about Screendance. I should also just give you a little, maybe you read my bio, so you don't, do you need much of a bio for me? I will say that I started as a choreographer and dancer. I had a company in San Francisco for about a decade, and I began to make screen dances then because my ideas just didn't fit on the stage. They transcended the stage. And I started by collaborating with cinematographers and editors and directors in San Francisco. And over time, and with their encouragement, began to take on some of those roles myself. And then went to graduate school late in my late 30s, early 40s. And while in graduate school, really kind of fully took on or learned how to edit and shoot and dived into the behind the camera side much more. And so now when I Screendance is still my creative medium of choice. And I still collaborate quite often with cinematographers and with designers, directors, choreographers. And then sometimes I wear the choreographer's hat or the director's hat. I kind of flow a little bit around that. I do usually edit my own work. That's something where I feel like that part of the choreography stays mine most of the time now. And then second part of my bio is once I became an academic and started to move farther and farther out of urban areas to get jobs. I taught in Wisconsin for a little while, and now I'm in Alabama. But the problem that I had known of as an art maker primarily, that it's really hard to find recorded versions of things you know exist. It's hard to see them. It's hard to share them. I dove into that more as an academic, and now I direct a nationwide project called Dancing Digital that is working to create better national access, especially to full-length works of dance. And I am jumping totally out of order, but I'm going to put the URL for that project in the chat here, just in case you want to peruse that. We just got a beautiful grant from the NEH to take what has been a planning project to the next level and create a prototype resource that's going to feature. It's going to feature the works of contemporary Black choreographers as the kind of model resource. But in a few minutes, it's this lighting ceremony. So I wonder if maybe we could just take a few minutes now, since before I kind of dive into more of the material about screen dances specifically. Does that sound okay? Should we take a minute or 2 minutes? What do you think? It's hard to commemorate 2 million dead across the globe with any kind of justice. I was just gonna talk a little bit about trends that I have seen in work made since the pandemic. And also just to say again, I definitely have things that I'd like to share with you, but I'm also hoping this can be a conversation. So I don't see this as, you know, wisdom coming down, flowing down from me, but I'll share what I'm thinking about, and I would really appreciate knowing what you're thinking about as well. So for me, immediately, I had a curiosity about when it became clear that theaters were shutting down. And as a practitioner specifically of screen dance, I have had a question about how would the field of dance access the knowledge that screen dance makers hold, or what kinds of relationships might come out of it, or what would be made? Where would people who are primarily concerned with creating for live performance, where would they turn to? What would be the first impulse? And the first thing that I noticed was the way we turn to screens immediately to find, to collapse the distances, to collapse time, space, even generations, to create a kind of unifying sense. So one of the first instances of this that I saw was right after everything shut down. I'm gonna attempt to share my screen here. I don't know if you saw the Ailey dancers put out this video of the beep section of Revelations, but I'm just gonna play a moment of that. This idea that even though we are now a diasporic community, we can still come together. We can still unify somehow in this screen space.
Thank you.
So that video jumped out at me. And then along the same different elements being unified, but along the same lines, Calvin Royal III's 1 year, which, let's see, there we go. So same idea, but this one takes one dancer across time. It's the same space, but it's multiple seasons. I don't know if you saw this. Get the idea with that one, right? You can probably think of a whole lot more. There was a dance theater of Harlem one around Harlem, with so something that's consistent among all of these is that there's one movement phrase kind of anchoring the different people or the different times or the different places. So there's one, this is a generational one. I'm back to Ailey again. You can still see my screen, right? I don't know if you saw this one, but many generations of the women who've performing Cry. Is that something that you saw? I don't know. Let me turn the sound on here. Do you have any thoughts about that? Is that something you observed as well? That meaning using screen space to unify, to say we're still one, we're still a community somehow. Or any other videos you want to add to that idea?
I'm looking for Maya, you have, I'm blanking on his name.
Mitchell Rose Globetrot?
No, Enrique.
Enrique? My friend Enrique, yeah. Which one?
This is tiny, and I don't mean to be negative, but I've watched no dance online during this pandemic because I find it really unsatisfying. The only dance online I've watched is Here and Now because I'm professionally involved with Miami Light Project and a lot of the artists.
And you did beautifully in it too.
Oh, thank you. So, but I was, Enrique Villacres is a dancer and choreographer here in Miami. He's a friend and I think sometimes creative partner of Maya. Yeah. I saw him in a live program recently and was really blown away by him as a dancer. And so I followed him on Instagram and there were some tiny snippets of footage of what he was doing, but what struck me about them was that he used the medium that he was working in as an asset. as a visual and creative and conceptual asset. He played with color and perspective and the ways he could manipulate what he was shooting or use what he was shooting. And it was it's tiny, but I thought it was, I just hadn't seen things that acknowledge the limitations and the particular aspects of shooting on a fucking cell phone. And space limitation and everything that comes with that. And so I thought that was a strength. And again, you know, I don't even know if I should say this because there's lots of stuff out there. There's lots of stuff out that I've watched very little because I wasn't drawn to it. And this was something that I was drawn to. I would think there must be other things out there that are doing something that's really creative.
I certainly hope
sorry
so.
Sorry, that's a tiny contribution. But,
Well, I mean, that's what we hope for, Jordan. That's what Screendance makers do as well. It's not a normal time. We can't necessarily create a shoot the way we would normally do so, but the idea of being conscious of the medium and making something specifically for it rather than just a documentation or a rework of something that is intended to be performed live, that is definitely what people like me are striving for. So I'm glad to hear that you saw a little bit of that. Did you want to add something, Maya?
Yeah, I was just looking for some
Instagram account. I can't.
Oh, his Instagram is Friesh, Friesh, if you're looking for Enrique. But the Batsheva dancers have been doing some really nice ones as well. At the very beginning, Bobby Jean Smith, I think she was kind of overseeing a music video that I can't find right now, but I did find the Batsheva, they have a thing every year where the dancers make their own pieces. And so this one was obviously online this year, but this one is really cool as well because they're playing a lot with the perspective of using the boxes in a way that furthers it. Right here, I can send you the link. I thought this one was nice as well. I also agree a lot about Enrique's work. He takes a lot of inspiration from anime and so he really creates this like surreal world in his films. And it's impressive the way he's been growing as an artist. So yeah, I put it the link in the
Maybe what we'll do is gather and then figure out what to watch together. Like we'll sort of see if anyone else wants to contribute anything to watch in this moment. And then maybe we can watch this Enrique's piece that you're talking about. Anyone else want to comment on any of the Ailey or the, what did I just show? The Calvin, Calvin's video. That sort of theme of one phrase, multiple dancers or multiple places or multiple generations or multiple seasons. And do you feel like that has resonance right now? Did any of that touch you at the beginning of the pandemic?
Yeah, it definitely did. It's there's something like so heartbreaking about them all. But then like the sheer beauty of them as well is such an interesting way for like, you know, the art to make you feel. So I think that there's a lot of beauty to these and the way we'll look back on them one day.
Yeah. I also feel like when I see dance films that were made pre-pandemic right now, sometimes they strike me as a little bit artificial because of this just stripped bare, fixed camera, cell phone in your living room kind of aesthetic that I've become used to. I'm also a little bit sick of seeing people dance in their living rooms, to be frank, but there is an intimacy there that I'm appreciating for sure. Okay, I am really curious to see this YouTube video that you are suggesting. Oops, come on. It's gonna be in another window altogether. Hang on, let's watch a little bit of this.
I don't know how much they actually dance in this though, now that I'm thinking about it.
Should we watch it? Or
I don't know. I'm realizing that maybe they don't actually dance. It's more of just this thing of being at home. Maybe there's something else that would be better for.
Okay. Oh, I wish I was just in a room with you all. Thank you for your patience with this medium that we're on here. I was referencing Mitchell Rose's Globetrot from back in 2014. I don't know if you saw that film. It really made the film festival circuits pretty thoroughly. Is that something you're familiar with? I mean, it was made super pre-pandemic with B.B. Miller, but it's like an anthem to me of this genre of pandemic filmmaking. So I just want to show you a moment of Globetrot, if I can. Pause that. I think you get the idea. I think it's 50 dancers in 23 countries, and kind of a neat editing trick because Mitchell Rose calls this match cutting because he gives very specific directions about framing when he kind of crowdsources this kind of film, but then he still has to resize and adjust the frame to keep the body in the right part and make it look continuous and make the phrase overlap and all of that kind of thing. So it's a pretty detailed project. And it just strikes me in a way as the forefather of this other idea of each of us in our living rooms trying to work together, trying to make something together, trying to show that we're in community. Again, with the phrase as the anchor, one phrase is the anchor in all the different places and times and people and all those good things. Do we want to go back to, sorry, I'm having trouble keeping track of the chat too. Oh, okay. Okay, great. Should we watch a little bit of this flamenco film? Is it the same kind of idea? Same theme? or just a beautiful film? Okay, I'm not sure. I'm gonna kind of keep going because I'm not sure. If you wanna speak up and let me know if you have more to add to this frame of reference that I'm presenting, that would be great. Otherwise, I'm just gonna keep going because I'm having a hard time keeping track of all of the chat and kind of moving forward.
I'll just speak up for one sec.
Yeah.
The thing that I, you know, all of that is heartening, the ALE work and a lot of what happened in terms of connecting and the simplicity and clarity of one phrase. What I'm much more drawn to is individual and idiosyncratic motion that's really about location, you know, site work, but not, and I saw quite a bit of that. I'm drawn a bit more to that because it's sometimes an unusual twist or something that, or experiences that one wouldn't really have, where you go so far in your limitation. So yes, you were going somewhere in the limitation in that each one was on screen and each one was doing one particular movement or whatnot phrase. But as a movement artist who really tries to go for less known material, I wasn't drawn as much to
those works. Yeah, okay. So this is, thank you, Cora. That's gonna kind of pull me into a theoretical direction that that might be helpful. So when we make work for, especially for our proscenium stage, traditional proscenium stage setup is that there's an audience out here focused in on performers in a box, right? That's the traditional proscenium setup. And usually the audience is wider than the proscenium. So there's a sort of a cone going on or a wedge in terms of sight lines going on, audience to stage. And when we translate something from live performance to the camera, we invert that wedge. And so then we have a lens opening into space in a cone. Does that kind of make sense? So when we think about what translates and what doesn't, obviously as choreographers, as dance makers, we're thinking very much about sight lines, but that inversion of sight lines is important to understand. And that certain things are gonna read well and certain things are gonna pop on screen that don't pop on stage and vice versa. So maybe just a quick conversation about some of that theory would help us get into this conversation a little bit more. So what are some of the differences in terms of what works on screen versus what works live in terms of space and time? So let's take space. What are some of the differences between screen space and how that works and live performance?
There have been clever, again, it's just more of a trick, but it's fun of, you know, having people look like they're, say, walking on the ceiling or whatever, but it's just the angle of the camera. All the framing and the zooming and the getting, yeah, super close or very, very detailed, like going into just what a hand is doing and then being able to come out and see the context, that kind of thing that we can't do as well when we're on stage. Seems so evocative spatially of being able to get very, very close and also to span way far away.
Yeah, so So we have a lot of potential in terms of proximity to the performer that we wouldn't have if we were in a traditional proscenium space. What about the fact that there's not necessarily a front if you're working in screen space? That's an important one.
I think it gives you a freedom in terms of how you approach the movement,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to on stage, because the space on stage is fixed.
Mm-hmm.
We have the advantage of the three-dimensional and we explore yeah. that. But in the camera, you have other perspectives that should be explored to compensate for no three-dimensional.
That's right.
The advantage of the three dimensions.
That's really well put, Lucia, thank you. To add on to what you're saying, you have the potential for camera movement. So it's not necessarily just the dancer who's moving. The dancer can be still and the movement can come from the camera instead of from the
dancer. And I think that adds to what you said before, that the editing is part of the choreography.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Which on stage, we don't have that. I mean, it's before, it's the process before. In my experience with the camera also, it gives you one that the dancer can improvise with the camera.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of things there were thought before, and sometimes even rehearsed, it can change completely at the time of filming. Like the film I have in the festival that I did with Joanne, that happened a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So the eye of the camera added that we didn't have when we were, because previously we were doing that piece for the stage, and we decided to film instead. So it completely changed. It's like almost another
yeah.
work altogether. So it was very interesting to witness that.
And that comes back to something that Jordan was saying, that you weren't just trying to document the thing that had existed live, yeah. but you,
it's a different,
you let it medium. Evolve, you let it become something that acknowledged its own medium, that took advantage of its own medium.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah.
So thinking about space, another quality in space, when we think about translating live dance performance to recorded performance, without some very careful use of depth of field and some consideration, oftentimes traveling across spaces doesn't read very well on camera. You know, that kind of, oh, you get when you see someone fly across a space physically. That same thing, you have to really set it up very intentionally to get any sort of kinetic glee out of that on camera. So there can be a kind of foreshortening and flattening of space that makes that harder to see. There's also the potential for what there's a Russian film theorist called Kuleshov, who talked about creative geometry. If any of you know Doctor Who, the Doctor Who series? Anyone know?
Just dub it.
Okay. So he has a spaceship called the TARDIS, which looks on the outside like a British phone box. But as soon as he walks into it, it's cavernous. It has multiple stories and different rooms. And so that's an example in a way of creative geometry. So you don't have to be in one location. You can construct a location out of multiple places. Walk through a doorway and find yourself in a different place. Turn away from the camera and find yourself in a forest. So there's a kind of a opening up of the potential for space that way with film. And in terms of time, what's different in terms of time and recorded dance?
Yeah, I mean, it's all like, the way I see dance on film is like at its core, it's an illusion. And by even it just being a two-dimensional thing that we perceive as three-dimensional. And it's same thing with time, just being able to like take a 5-minute film that happens over the course of an entire night, that kind of thing. The way that it can like shorten or expand on a moment where like, you know, a 30-second moment could become like a 5-minute piece and
yeah,
the other way around.
Yeah. So
being able to use that is like such a strong tool for a film, being able to show the passage of time in any way that you want.
Yeah.
That I'm always really interested in.
Yeah, that's well put. One of the examples that we use a lot of professors use is Hilary Harris's 9 Variations on a Dance Theme, shot in 1966. I think it's 9 minutes long, but it was shot over a year. It's one phrase shot over a year. But it doesn't feel like a year. It feels like you've just been in the studio for those 9 minutes. And like you said, you can take a 30 second, you can take a fall and make it last 30 minutes. Right, so there's the potential to, to manipulate speed, repetition, and even reverse movement. There's a lot of ways to manipulate time on screen. But another just sort of interesting limitation is that we tend to be less patient watching things on screens. So if you're documenting something that happened in performance and it feels luscious and spacious, sometimes on film, or recorded, it can feel way too slow. So that's also just another observation that I have. I'm gonna just show you a couple more things that have stuck out to me over the last 10 months. And then I wanna kind of flip into this discussion of access and legacy a little bit and where we find ourselves within the pandemic landscape in reference to those questions. So, I think it was Cora that was talking about location being one of the things that interests her. The Lines, Alonzo King's Lines Ballet has a series of 5 works that they put out called There's No Standing Still. And in the very first one of those, where'd you go? There's one of the most beautiful uses of location that I've ever seen in a dance film. Can you see that? You can see that. And it's what's kind of sad to me is it's mostly just this first clip and then the rest are a little bit disappointing, but here we go. Just gonna stop that there. Stop share. The first moment with the woman in the forest for me is really transcendent. It looks like it's shot with a phone. It's a stationary camera. There's nothing fancy from a cinematographic point of view going on, but it just gets it right for me in that the movement supports the location, adds to the location, and the location adds to the movement. They're symbiotic, they're joined. And it's also her costume and how she's moving. But I don't know if you agree with me about that. For me, it was kind of an exquisite moment over the last few months to see the beginning of that. The next clips are less, they feel less integrated in terms of location and movement. The gentleman with the brick wall feels like he's doing a separate thing than the space around him. But I wanted to just share that one, what feels like a glorious moment to me. So thank you for watching. another piece that has stood out for me is a piece that Donald Byrd made for the Guggenheim Works in Progress, Works in Process, sorry, series. I don't know if any of you have seen that, but this very much is about, and maybe touches a little about what we've talked about, using what's available to you right now. To me, this was a beautiful way of using cell phone photography, as well as archival video that Donald Byrd had of a previous work. So I think for this one, I'm just gonna put the link in the chat for you to check out on your own time to make sure that we don't run out of time. And if you're curious, I recommend that work. Very much about an interpersonal relationship and memory and race and a lot with the materials at hand, edited in a really smart way with the materials at hand. Okay, so shifting gears, anyone have any other comments about anything I've shown or any thoughts about what you've seen made? Trends that you've seen, things that excite you in the last 10 months. Okay. All right, I'm just, sorry, yes.
I don't even, it's because I'm a writer, but it might be ridiculous for me to say something given that I haven't watched dance on film, but it just seems to me that if people are going to watch on a screen and that, you know, on probably on this tiny little screen.
Yeah.
Right. Then for it to work, it has to start from here. It has to start with the qualities and limitations and possibilities of the medium. It's like, I don't like watching live theater on TV. I think the work has to be tailored to the medium. I think if you translate it, loses. Maybe I'm wrong, and because I've seen so little, but it just, like those, that Ailey, that little snippet of Ailey, you know, doing the bit of I've been buked. I moved because I think of the beautiful Ailey dancers, and I've seen that piece so many times, but as a piece of work, does absolutely nothing for me. Mm-hmm. I never want to see anybody dancing in their living room ever again. Mm-hmm.
Well, this is a great this is a great transition, Jordan. Thank you. You served that up. So I appreciate that. And that's not a silly thing to say at all. Those of us who, and I know that that includes all of us here pretty much, but for those of us who've spent a lot of years thinking about how dance translates to the screen, there has been something a little bit painful about the last 10 months. It's been like watching a field going through growing pains and doing so, in a lot of unsatisfying ways at times, but going through sort of a necessary process of trying to figure out what are the strengths, what can be presented in this size, what are the strengths, what is the geometry, as I was talking about, what works, what doesn't work, so this is a great segue into this other kind of hat that I wear as the director of the Dancing Digital Project. So I have wondered for years why dance doesn't have a fuller, more well-realized presence in digital space, why we've been hesitant as a field to share our recorded works and to shape the spaces where we share our recorded works to fit our needs, our specific needs. And one of the areas that I have been sort of preaching about for a long time is that dancers aren't trained to understand digital space as a performance venue, right? We take choreography classes, we teach choreography classes. We don't teach separate choreography classes for proscenium stages and thrust stages. We expect choreographers to know how to make certain adaptations to site-specific performance, to all sorts of different ways of making dance in space. And my argument is that digital space is one of those, and that choreographers should know how to access and find the strengths of digital space so that we can share work in a way that's true to our vision, in a way that only we know how to do as dance makers, rather than farming that out necessarily to mainstream cinematographers and editors. We have a vision. We have a particular choreographic vision that I would like the dance community as a whole to understand better. And so this time when we've all been thrust into this two-dimensional venue has been really interesting, because in a way it has, it's forced people to understand the importance of having some sort of footprint in online space, right? So that you can be found, so that you can reach audiences during this difficult time, so that you can share work during this difficult time. But it's also felt a little bit painful. Great, okay. Hi, Farah, welcome. Welcome, Emily, too. Oh, yes, go ahead. You're not just waving.
Well, I'm waving, but then I also just wanted to make one comment.
Sure, please.
About this topic. I really love some of this stuff that I've seen in the last 10 months, because I think it's led to some incredible creativity. And not that it wasn't there before, but it's just, I found it beautiful. I really love screen dance because I love not being limited in your backdrop and in your scenery. And you can do that if you're in wide open spaces and if you're outdoors, and the contrast sometimes can be incredibly beautiful with something that's maybe more industrial and with this beautiful dance piece. And I mentioned the flamenco show in El Prado because I think it's incredibly gorgeous. And I really loved it because it's a space that's inaccessible right now because you can't go to the museum. And so they're using it, because it's empty, as this dance stage. And they did this incredible flamenco show that everybody can see, that's accessible to everyone in this beautiful location. So it's like this dance form that is not widely accessible, generally speaking, maybe. And the museum, which is, you have to go to Madrid to see it, they made it widely accessible to everyone. And so I don't think that would have been done if it had, if, you know, if the situation had been different. So I thought that was really amazing. And it wasn't dance, but there was something similar that was done with the symphony orchestra where they played to plants. They put plants.
Yeah, I heard about that.
And I thought that was incredibly beautiful and creative too. So, and then another dancer, I think it was in Miami, unfortunately, I can't remember the name of this dancer right now, but he did something in a parking garage and it was really expressive and beautiful too. So those are just some of the things that I've seen that I really appreciate.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes. I also didn't mean to say that this whole 10 months has been disappointing. So thank you for bringing that up. But I think, yes, there's been a lot that's beautiful that's been made. We've been resourceful as a community. There's a lot that's worth watching. So I didn't mean to disregard that. And there's also some stuff that you can see the growing pains as you watch as well. So it's kind of a two-sided thing. Maya, did you want to say something and add something?
Yeah, I feel so strongly this similarly to you, Emily, and I have been blown away by the way that I'm able to, like, now I take class with choreographers who I love in Europe from my living room, and I get to go to like NDT shows and like these shows that I have never had access to before. Now I can sit in my living room and study things that I never had the chance to before. And to me, it's like, as artists, it's like what we do is adapt, and we make transitions more comfortable for people. That's like part of what art is. And so it's like the way I see it is, you know, what can we just gain from this time? It's like, okay, so we are losing out on some things, but there's also so much that we're learning from in it too. So that's the way I feel like I've chosen to like experience this time with dance, and it helps. Helps to keep me inspired by thinking of it in that way. It just in the trend stuff, the being able to access things that you'd never have.
Okay, great. Thank you. Yes. So what do we want to keep? So this is great. So where the project that I work on, the Dancing Digital project, intersects with this is that all of a sudden, all of these videos have been shared, right? Like, companies whose recorded works you've never been able to see, just like you were saying, Maya, all of a sudden whole seasons of full-length recorded works have been shared. And the lack of full-length works especially has been a problem for us as a community. It's been hard to show the works you want to share, find the works you want to see in recorded form. And that has ramifications for those of us who teach, and for those of us who research dance. And so how do we, where do you think we are in terms of our attitude towards sharing? Do you think that this has jogged our attitude towards sharing, and how? Discuss. Yeah, go ahead. Emily.
Well, I think creatives of all sorts have been incredibly generous in this past 10 months. And I found that very inspiring and uplifting. I'm an actress. And so I've been able, similar to what Maya was saying, I've been able to take classes online with studios in LA, and I live in Memphis, Tennessee. So it's made, and a lot of, it's made the world more accessible, because more, if you want to do something, you have to do it online, but that opens it up to a world audience, not just a small geographic area, but a much wider audience. And a lot of people, because they want to make a contribution during these times, because of the suffering that's going on, a lot of people have been very generous in offering free classes and putting their work up, or just not asking for permission, just going for it. They have something to express. And again, I really liked what Maya said about, in difficult times, artists help people to get through it and to understand it and to make it more comfortable. So I see that's really amazing too. There's so much more accessible, many creative people from dance, from theater, from film, you name, like all artists have been very generous in sharing their talent and in opening up workshops for free or for very low cost to give people something to look at or to do or to be a part of. And I think that there have been some incredible communities, like artistic communities, that have opened up online too. And people are being very generous and very free in a lot of ways.
So you said generous a lot, and I'm wondering how we keep that feeling of magnanimity and still support ourselves. Like, do you see some ways where, because we have made a lot available for free. There has been a desperation behind that, right? Of needing to share. What do we keep and how do we leverage some of that so that we also can eat? Were you gonna say something, Cora? And was it around that idea?
It was more on the line of just theater and accessibility, but also in digging into what's really happening in the world through theater of war productions is a fairly amazing group that does readings from Greek tragedies. I actually just started watching them because an actress that I love was doing a reading. They just do like pared down readings, but then they do panels with real people. So, you know, they did Antigone and Ferguson, for example, and had people that had lost their sons through police violence. And that none of that was as accessible. It is worldwide and it's amazing, and it's both amazing artistically what they're doing, even though it's pared down, it's really just readings, you know, but they have Bill Murray, they have these amazing people offering their talents. But then they have all this dialogue after with both the panelists, but then they open it up incredibly beautifully. It's worth seeing. I got into it before realizing that the dude that Brian Dory is that runs it is actually a Kenyan, where I teach, Kenyan alum. But what it showed me and what I'm curious about as in dance, which sometimes gets quite rarefied, is how can we both keep some of that accessibility that you just talked about, keep the connectivity worldwide. So yes, like being able to see good work in Europe. But also what is it to be more pared down, to have like super vital discussions about work versus only seeing it kind of anonymously and not having the dialogue piece. Things like that are what that body of work has made me curious about.
I think we can have this accessibility. I think we can have the added content and the intimacy with the artists that we get when we get to take class with somebody in a different country and we are in that person's living room for a little while working with them. Or we have access to these panels that you're describing. I think we can do that and still come back to live performance. And I think that music is a fraught model. There's a lot we could talk about in terms of streaming and how that's affected music artists. But we do get to know a lot about music based on recorded music. We do come into contact with new art through recorded music, essentially, most of the time. And I don't know about you, but for me, hearing something that piques my interest will make me seek out an artist, will make me want to attend the live concert. The two don't cancel themselves out. And when I've become acquainted with that artist, and when I go to see the live concert, I don't expect that that concert is going to sound exactly the same as the recording. I'm an educated enough music consumer to know that recorded music and live music are different. And I think that that's something that we can aspire to as dance makers and activate better for ourselves within the field. And I think that the more of us have the know-how to design what we show and the spaces in which we show it online, the better we can balance, the better we can advocate for ourselves, the better we can create a footprint for ourselves in digital space that can result in live audience, that can feed live performance, and that can feed recorded performance, and all of it can work together. There's my hopeful wish for us. Yeah.
I just have to say that I agree so much with that, that the digital space for dance has created fans of live performance as well that may have never had any idea of that world. No way of ever seeing it before until they saw something online. And I think that it helps to breed more interest for an average person to be feel like, okay, maybe I can go to a dance show and I will understand some of it. Because there's a lot of things that a lot of people are just like, I don't get it, you know, and what is that? And I think having the digital space just creates so much more room for people to be interested in when we are able to come back fully in a live way. And I have experienced that for myself, that a lot of people have come to my live performances because they were first accessed it in a digital way.
Yeah. Yeah. I also have had the same experience. And that probably the most mainstream and cheesiest example of that is So You Think You Can Dance. No matter what you think of it, those live shows sell out. They sell out all over the world. And thousands of male dancers have been hooked. Thousands of men have been hooked into dance because of their exposure to that TV program. There's a lot more we could say about that. But yes, I agree with you, Maya. And at the same time, I don't want us to rely on So You Think You Can Dance. I don't want us to rely on Google Arts and Culture. I don't want us to rely on frameworks that are not made by us. We have a vision for what we want to say and how we want to say it. And we need to know how to use those tools to frame those spaces and to say those things in complete form, not as trailers, not as excerpts, unless we want them to be excerpts, but we really need to rethink what we make available and how that feeds the models that compensate us and sustain us. Gosh, I'm just doing this round gesture today. This is my gesture. But that's the idea that feels most important to me to take away from this time. We have discovered so much, and so many people are more literate in terms of what's possible on a screen, what can be conveyed on a screen, how that can hit us, how that can be utilized. And so let's take all of that knowledge, let's take those ideas and not just turn away from them, but leverage them and massage them and create the spaces we want to see online and in recorded form that support live performance. Huzzah! Rebecca came to a climax. Okay. Well, thank you all very much. We're out of time, and I so appreciate. I wonder if Louisa, if we can share the transcript of the chat with the attendees, because there are so many wonderful links that have been shared here that I haven't had a chance to look at or reference in this class. Would that be possible? Or Evans, Either one of you, can you help me chime in there?
Hello.
Hi, Evan.
Yeah, we will have the chats and the videos, but we just have to figure out how to actually share those files. But we will have them. We will have the chats saved. So we do have your information. Luisa was taking your information in the chat. So we can actually send those to you guys. That would not be an issue.
Thank you so much, because that would be great. I'm really looking forward to having the time to dive into the links you shared. Thank you so much, Evans and Luisa, and thank you again, Miami Light Project, and congratulations to those of you showing work in this project. Be well. May this week go peacefully. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.